morning, everyone. It's Father C with your Monday morning message for Monday, August 14th. Just to recap this weekend, I want to thank everyone for attending Mass. It was great to see so many people and those who watched online. It's good to have you with us. Just to recap the Gospel, you know, the Gospel challenges us about life and faith. In life, sometimes we're in a boat and you have waves crashing at it. And that's life. You know, you have your ups and downs, your peaks and valleys, your hurdles that we face. Now, the question we have to ask ourselves is when we do have a crisis of faith, who do we turn to? You know, here they are in the midst of storm, and they see Jesus walking on the water, and Peter says, "If it's you, let me come to you." And what is Jesus' response? "Come here. Come." But as soon as he realizes the strength of the wind, he begins to doubt and he begins to sink. It demonstrates, you know, Peter, and we'll talk about his example, but, you know, that sinking, sometimes, my dear brothers and sisters, is, you know, a reminder of the crisis of faith I think we face in today's world. You know, when things begin to get rough, it's so easy for us to begin to sink. Now, let's go back to St. Peter. What did St. Peter do as soon as he began to sink? "Lord, save me! Lord, save me!" You know, imagine being in the middle of an ocean and all of a sudden you're beginning to sink. What are you going to do? Cry out in absolute desperation. That's what Peter did. But when we struggle, what do? Do we cry out to God? Or do we come away from him, draw away from him? And that's the question. And I think a lot of times in our world today, we face this crisis of faith. And when we face a hurdle, we turn away from God. And I used two examples of movies for this past weekend. The first one was the movie Fireproof. Kurt Cameron's character Caleb. You know, there's a crisis in the marriage, and he's speaking to his father, and he says, "How do you love someone who doesn't love you in return?" And standing by the cross, father looks up. He said, and Caleb's character says, "It's not the same." But his response was, "Is it? It is." No matter what, no matter how many times we reject God, God loves us. God loves us, no matter how many times we reject him. And sometimes when we make the choice to love, we love. And that's what we need to pray for. We need to pray that we're able to love as God loves. But, you know, Caleb's character is a good example in that movie. Do we cry out to God? You know, we express ourselves to God. Do we open ourselves completely? Just like Peter did, you know, in an act of desperation. "Lord, save me." Do we cry out to God? And that's what we need to ask ourselves, as Caleb did. Now, in life, you know, sometimes, you know, the hurdles, sometimes, you know, changing. You know, changes can bring challenges and difficulties. I use the movie, the example of Jesus Revolution. And the movie Jesus Revolution, which I saw a couple months back, Kelsey Grammer's character, the minister, is inviting a group of people in, and the elders of the church weren't happy about it. It was the hippies. You know, here you have the proper churchgoers, you know, the suit and tie, and you have this new group of individuals. And, you know, a lot of those individuals, because they were searching, got roped into different things. And so he opened his door to them. You know, one of the funniest moments is when they laughed, as, you know, basically said, "Well, they're bare feet, and they're going to get the new 1970s shag carpet dirty." So what did Kelsey Grammer's character do? Is he welcomed, sat on the step of the church and washed their feet. And welcomed them into the church. Sometimes when we do something new, there's turmoil. But the importance of having faith is absolutely necessary. And so, you know, I encourage you, my dear brothers and sisters, always have faith, you know, no matter what. Even when the storms are, you know, rocky, it's important to listen to the voice of God. And remember where the voice of God is. The voice of God isn't in, you know, the loudest noise. It isn't in the majority, it isn't in the minority. The voice of God is often in the quiet whisper. And that's what we try to do. We try to listen to God. And so part of that is also being attentive and observant and, you know, not being afraid to do that. So, you know, that was this weekend. Now we're coming up to this coming week. We're at the Feast of the Assumption, the Solemnity. It's a holy day of obligation. Mass tonight's at 5:30. And the Mass tomorrow is at 9, noon, and 7. And so we talk about new things. The 7 o'clock Mass, which is, you know, Tuesday night, first off, and it's normally the Spanish Mass, we'll be celebrating a bilingual liturgy. Now, the bilingual liturgy for Tuesday night is going to be the second reading in Spanish, the Mass parts of the Eucharistic prayer, the Santo, the Holy Holy, the Memorial Acclamation, Lamb of God, will be in Spanish, and then also communion meditation piece will be sung in Spanish. The rest of the Mass will be in English, as we speak about new things. But, you know, we have a very good Hispanic community. It's definitely growing. And we as a parish are looking to provide, you know, opportunities for them to gather. They're living in our parish. Any person who lives within our parish boundaries is our pastoral responsibility. So even if I have a member of the American community living in New Oxford but might be going to Annunciation, St. Joe's Hanover, St. Francis Gettysburg, Sacred Heart Basilica, if they live in New Oxford or the facility in the boundaries, you know, they are technically our pastoral responsibility to serve. And so this is their territorial parish. They may be registered somewhere else, but territorially they're here, and we do provide, you know, pastoral opportunity. With the Hispanic community, some members are going to Gettysburg, some are going to Hanover, and some are going to stay with those communities. But we also have a good number of individuals who live within our parish boundaries, but because of, you know, issues with transportation, work, are unable to make it to those Masses. So we're providing them another opportunity to do that. I do have members from St. Francis, Hispanic community, and St. Joseph Hanover, who do help us, you know, work with us. So I'm very appreciative of that, and I want to acknowledge that. You know, and the idea is we build and grow and provide. You know, I'm trying to do so without making any major drastic moves. You know, 7 o'clock bilingual is a way of inviting them in order to, you know, grow the community. The same thing, I announced this weekend that the September 17th will begin a bilingual liturgy. The 5 o'clock will be transitioned to a bilingual liturgy to serve both communities. Now, that Mass is going to be a little bit different than what we're doing for the Holy Day. The first, third, and fifth Sunday, the hymns and the readings will be in Spanish, but the ordinary of the Mass will be in English. So the collects, the creed, the, you know, words of the Eucharistic prayer will be in English, but the Mass parts, the, you know, will be in Spanish. And then the opposite weeks, the second and fourth, the hymns and the readings will be in English, and the Mass parts will be in Spanish. Again, trying to, you know, work with both communities. You know, we did not make any changes. I didn't change the Mass time, didn't change the Mass schedule. I know this is a little bit different, and again, change is difficult. But it's, I think, important as we begin to build, grow, strengthen, and support our parish. And in the idea for bilingual liturgy, I also believe it's a bridge. You know, as we invite the Hispanic community into our parish, we need to recognize their culture, which is unique to them. We also need to recognize the gifts that they bring, which is different than our own. As a priest, I don't believe in a simulation. I'm not trying to make them, you know, us. I'm trying to cultivate the gifts that they bring, recognize the gifts that they bring, and provide opportunities for us to experience them and them to experience us. You know, we're ultimately one family of faith. So I'm a true believer in the bilingual liturgy. Also, to understand, my dear brothers and sisters, to help us as the American community to understand, you know, their need. There is an interest among them to learn English, to experience English. You know, they want to maintain their culture, their identity, but there's a desire. They love them. They love, you know, the United States. They love being here. You know, there's a desire to learn. Now, imagine if, you know, we're trying to learn another language older. If I'm trying to learn Spanish now, you know, it's difficult. You know, I'm not a native speaker, and it's difficult. If I try to learn Chinese. Now, for me to do that, it'd be difficult. I, you know, it would take me a very long time if it would be possible. It's much difficult to learn something when you're older than when you're younger. So a lot of the younger generation, you know, they're going to school with our kids, they're learning, they're reading, able to write. They can do both languages, and they're bilingual. Some of their family, not so much. You know, spoken word for them is also important. You know, within the community, we, you know, recognize there's a level of, you know, illiteracy, as there's members in the American community too. So some of the, you know, the spoken word has helped them understand, and so it's a bridge, and for them to experience English and hear it, it's a good thing. And for us to hear their language, to learn another language is not a bad thing. And many of our people are trying to learn Spanish. You know, we have people that learn French. I mean, learning more than one language is beneficial. It could be helpful. And so my encouragement to us is just to, you know, to give it time. You know, and as I mentioned, recognize that they do have their own culture, they have their own gifts, and to observe them. You know, observe what they do for Our Lady Guadalupe. You know, so, you know, we just had them present the statue to Our Lady Guadalupe. Observe them, and, you know, see what they do, and you know, allow that to stir in our heart. Well, maybe we can do things. Maybe we should be doing May processions, Eucharistic processions. We should be doing this. And I go, well, that's a good idea. Roll with it. And, you know, a lot of the things that they're doing under their own initiative. I mean, they'll tell me, Father, would you be available to do this? I say, absolutely. I'd love it if everybody would run with their own initiative. And that's why, you know, at Mass, I was talking about the Bible studies, encouraging a group. You know, these things, there's things important. Being in community is important. And so, you know, I cannot stress that enough. And so, you know, I saw the, you know, when we brought the statue in, it was a beautiful, you know, opportunity. A beautiful thing to witness. And, you know, I want to recognize that. And so I do acknowledge that change is difficult. And, but my encouragement to you is to be open. Be open. And because when we open our hearts to other, you know, we learn so many things. It's so beneficial. And so my encouragement to you is just to open your heart. You know, I know I talk about, you know, in my writings, you know, there are a couple instances that, you know, I think I have to speak out against, and, you know, any type of discrimination. And discrimination doesn't have to be against, you know, a particular ethnicity. It can also be, and, you know, we've always done it this way, I'm not going to do it any other way. You know, that could be a form of discrimination. You know, it's there. It's in our hearts. You know, there's no doubt, you know, with that. And so with any type of discrimination, my goal is to, with speaking with a pastoral heart, is to try to shrink it and to allow it naturally to dissipate. You know, the more we learn about each other, the more I think, you know, we're better off in the long run. It's really a blessing. And so, you know, I see the opportunity for bilingual liturgy really as a blessing for our great parish. Also, Wednesday evening, we have our first meeting of OCIA, formerly RCIA. Anybody interested in learning more about the Catholic faith, just come join us at the Parish Center at 6:30. Come in door 6. You know, we'll see you there, welcome you there, get you started in the process of, you know, growing your relationship with God. So if you know anybody who's interested about Catholic faith or, you know, wants to learn more, join us on Wednesday evening the 16th at 6:30 p.m. I apologize, my voice is starting to go. I have allergies. I also posted that on the September 1st, we will have our first family, first Friday film. The movie chosen is Dolphin Tale. And so that'll be in the Parish Center at 7 o'clock, and we'll do that every first Friday. Also, youth ministry is also mentioned in this weekend's bulletin. The third Friday of September, middle school, grades 5 through 8. Most middle school 6th grade, but you know, lowered it down to 5th grade. And then also our high school meet on the third Sunday of the month from after Mass till 8:30. And that's for high school students, grades 9 through 12. So, you know, I do want to provide opportunity for our youth, our families, to come together. Community is important. You know, it's great to see so many of the parish picnic. so I think that's a, you know, tremendous sign. You know, tremendous sign of coming together as a community. Community is important. Community is important in the sense that, you know, we're reminded that we're not alone. We're all in this together, and we have each other for support. And so I cannot stress that enough, the importance of community. So we've got a lot going on, a lot of wonderful things, a lot of blessings, you know, and I just encourage you to, you know, to open your heart. You know, as I talk about some of those things, I know change is hard. Brothers and sisters, I know it's difficult, and I know because I am Pennsylvania Dutch, born and raised in York County, change is difficult. We don't like change. In my pastoral experience as a seminarian and as a priest, I have experienced different cultures. And every culture is unique, it's beautiful, and so much that we can learn. And so my encouragement to you is just open your heart. Allow great God in. The Lord is inviting you to come to Him on the water. Come. And don't doubt. Jesus said to Peter, "Oh, you little faith, why did you doubt?" Don't doubt God. Don't doubt His invitation. Come. And truly, if we open our hearts to everything and to all the good things that are happening, we can say, as the disciples said in the boat, truly, you are the Son of God. Truly, God is at work. God is at work in our great parish. And, you know, final thing, you know, God, as I said this before, God has really blessed our parish. God has blessed our parish because of your generosity and support, through your Sunday offering, through your volunteering, through your support of the fundraisers, through the thrift shop, the turkey dinners. Don't forget about the Taco Sunday that we're having in a couple weeks. You know, the Hispanic community is inviting us in. Come enjoy a couple tacos. You know, supporting their Our Lady of Guadalupe celebration, but you know, it's also an opportunity for us to gather. The taco dinner is actually in person, so you can sit at a table and you eat, you know, come together as a family. So consider that as an opportunity. The fundraisers, thrift shop, you know, tremendous things. And we've also been blessed by two generous gifts to Bequest. And with the sale of the convent, we've been able to retire the parish deficit. We're definitely in different, you know, not that we don't have our challenges. You know, we do have our challenges. But at the same time, you know, we're in much better shape than we were a couple years ago. And so I want to, you know, point that out. And, you know, we're all part of that. We're all a part of that, working together as a team. And even if you, people are unable to support financially, if you give of your time and your talent, you know, that's important. That's a way of giving. And so any way we can do that, you know, we all have different gifts. Let's bring them to the table. Let's work together. Why do we do this? Why is all this good things happen? Well, we need to do something. And I think what we need to do is give glory to God. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The Lord be with you, and with your spirit. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace, and work in the vineyard of the Lord. And we'll see you all next Sunday, and God bless you.